The word of the Lord. The psalm today is Psalm 78, verses 1 to 4 and 12 to 16. God gave them drink as from the great deep. Hear my teaching, O my people. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable.
I will declare the mysteries of ancient times.
That which we have heard and known, and what our forefathers have told us, we will not hide from their children. We will recount to generations to come the praiseworthy deeds and the power of the Lord, and the wonderful works he has done. He worked marvels in the sight of their forefathers,
in the land of Egypt, fields and stone.
He split open the sea and let them pass through.
He made the waters stand up like walls.
He led them with a cloud by day,
and all the night through with a glow of fire.
He split the hard rocks in the wilderness,
gave them drink as from the great deep.
He brought streams out of the cliff,
and the waters rushed out like rivers.
The second reading is from Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. If there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Jesus Christ, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him, and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The word of God.
Thanks be to God. The sequence hymn is My Faith Looks Up to Thee, in hymnal 691. Again, hymnal 691.
Thank you. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching, saying, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" They argued with one another, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, son.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going to the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Our dear Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name we thank you, for your name is great. Lord, you call us every day to serve you with love. And oh Lord, we go through a lot in life. We submit ourselves to your authority this morning, that you may remind us through your holy scriptures, correct us, Lord, and fix our attitudes, and also make us responsible for the responsibility you've given us, oh Lord, to love you with all our heart, mind, strength, and soul, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. We know it's not easy because we get discouraged. Lord, there's a lot going on in our lives and around us. We pray that you may help us, Lord, by your Spirit, the indwelling power that dwells in us, that we may be able to overcome all these things through Christ our Lord. And may the words of our mouths, meditations of our hearts be pleasing unto you, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. This day I want to talk about, how do you feel encouraged in the midst of discouragement? And how do you keep serving even when everybody around you is complaining and quarreling and doing things against your spirit and the only energy that you're left with to serve? How do you thrive in such situations? How are you able to have joy in serving or in doing that which you've been called to do when you have reasons, a thousand reasons of yield to complain? So I was reading these two scriptures, I found words like quarrels, things like fix your attitude, things like by whose authority are you doing all these things. And in our lives we go through a lot. We have discouragements, we have a lot of pressures around, pressures from the family, pressures from friends, from our enemies, at the workplace. Things are not going okay in our personal life, but we're still expected to have that joy of serving Jesus Christ, whether in our families, whether at your workplace, or whether at church. Two things that are expected of us through the covenant of baptism, that we are supposed to keep the fire burning, we are supposed to raise the banner of Christ high, we are supposed to keep representing Christ in the way that the world will see Jesus in you, in the way you conduct yourself. We need to keep defending our faith by our actions, not just by our words. But it's never easy. So last week, we talked about situations where people are complaining so much. How do you thrive? There is envy and jealousy. But today I want us to see how can we pick up from what we learned last week and connect and know how can we have this joy in the midst of all these quarrels, complaining, jealousy, envy. You come from a family where there's a lot of strife, there's a lot of disagreements. People are fighting, spouses are arguing every morning, disagreeing over everything. How do you still thrive in those circumstances? So I realized two things. One is that for me to keep going and having this joy of Christ is to know there's a difference between joy and happiness. You may look up these words in your own kind of references, but the one understanding I have is that happiness is short-lived, and it could be outside. I may be smiling, looking happy, but from deep inside me, I don't mean it. But joy is kind of more permanent in a way that it's something you cannot take away from me. It's from inside out, but happiness from outside, reflected from outside, but doesn't necessarily reflect what is going on inside me. Are you happy this morning, or you have joy? Both of them. That's a good answer. But now, some of you may be smiling, but a lot is going on inside your heart. There's so much going on inside your mind. There's so much going on around your life, in your family, where you come from, whatever you do, at workplace. You may be seated here, but this is the only chance that you have to be happy and smile with others. Two things you're supposed to have to remember is, one, always have the attitude of Christ. Number one is attitude. Number one is what? Attitude. Number two is that keep shining brightly for Christ. Do whatever you do for the angels of God to clap for you, for Christ to keep smiling on you, and for God himself to smile. Because if you put your target to the appreciation and rewards of the people around you, you'll be discouraged in the morning. Two things you need to know, and Paul is addressing this to the Philippians. He says that you have this joy in serving Christ by having the attitude of Christ and shining brightly for Christ regardless of the situation you're in. Treat every situation as you have an opportunity to look for God. Whether you are in pain, whether you are happy, whether the situation is good or bad, can you look for God? Don't see how big the problem is. See how big the God you believe in is. Now, let me do a link up of what we did last week so that I may connect the two with what the scriptures are saying. We talked about jealousy and envy. We said that someone who has envy will want what you have, and by what means they'll look for it or come for it. Someone who is jealous, they want to keep what they have, and they can do anything to prevent you from getting it from them. So this envy and this what? Jealousy. And we say that in this church probably there are no people who are envious, there are no people who have jealousy. But we know of people, we know of situations where we've encountered this. So do you try to keep hold of what you have and you defend that nobody else should take that from you? That's jealousy. Do you try to admire and look for what your things that people have and you want to have that so badly by whatever means? That's envy. I don't know what you've got as the meaning for these two words, but we say that these two things are very dangerous and they kill our happiness and joy every day. How does this happen? We say that the harmful effects of envy and jealousy, number one, is that it denies you the uniqueness of God. We say that everybody is unique. You have different thumbprints, eyeprints, thumbprints. Everything is different. We have different heartbeats, all of us. And therefore, whenever you have envy or jealousy, you destroy your own uniqueness in God. The second thing is that it kind of divides your attention. If you're paying attention on the east, and your attention is also geared towards the west. So your attention is divided. The third thing that is very harmful is that when you are jealous or envious, it's a waste of time. We saw this by what Jesus was teaching in the parable, that the owner of the vineyard came and he picked people from 9 to work, others from 12, others at 3 o'clock, others at 5. But when he came to pay them, he paid them the same amount of salary. And he gave them the same wages, regardless of whether you came very early or late. And those who can come very early in the morning were complaining, how come we are being paid the same amount of money like those who just work for 2 hours? It's human to do so, right? But now you realize that they are asking, how can we say that those who complain and complain and complain, the owner of the vineyard tells them, are you jealous of my kindness? Are you trying to tell me how I should spend my hard-earned money? So we say that they wasted their own time and energy complaining, but they never changed the owner of the vineyard, his mind. They did not change his mind at all. He still did what he had planned to do. And this is us in life sometimes. We complain about so many things that we cannot fix. They gave like an example. We even complain about the ordinary things that we have. We fail to see basic things like the air we breathe. We don't see it as a gift. When you wake up in the morning and open your eyes, who told you it's a guarantee that you wake up, you have to see what is around you? It's not always. It's a great, great miracle. Who told you that you have someone has to speak and you listen and hear what they are saying? It's a great miracle. Who told you that you have to put food in your mouth, eat you, and swallow? It's a miracle. There are people struggling in hospitals, not because God doesn't love them, not because he loves you better than he does, but every day you see a day, you see people, it's an opportunity for you to give thanks to God. Stop being jealous. Stop being envious of what people have or what you have and you don't want to share. God has called us to eradicate this in different ways. We say that jealousy is so bad because it's one of the seven great sins. It leads to more other sins. Because someone who is envious, the next thing they can do is to kill or to cause more harm. Someone who is jealous, the next thing they can do is to kill or cause more harm in order to retain what they have. These things are very harmful. Are they in churches? Are they in churches? Are these things in our families? Do we have jealous people in our families? Yes or no? Do we have jealous people at workplaces? Yes or no? Do we have jealousy and envy in church? I thought it's a holy place. Now, how can we take care of this in our individual lives? How can we eradicate jealousy and envy? We say, number one, there are four sins. We say that all stop comparing yourself with others. What you have is very unique and use it well. It's God-given. Look for God in whatever you're able to do. Stop complaining. What is the first sin? Stop complaining. The second one we say is what? No, stop comparing yourself. The second one is stop complaining. So the two sins I've given. Stop. Number one is stop comparing yourself with others. You see the goodness of serving God and doing everything, enjoying your life. Number two is stop complaining. We complain so much. We complain about this, about that. We're just wasting our time. Because the owner of the vineyard, he has bestowed upon each and every person the grace that is sufficient to do that which he expects us to do. That parable wasn't about rewards. It was about the grace in which we are able to do that which you're able to do. If you're able to identify every person's strength, abilities, as the grace bestowed upon them by God, you'll have a lot of peace. Because some of you here are able to do 10 things at a certain time. Others can only do one. So if you can do one, you'll appreciate those who are able to do 10 things. Those who can do five. We have different abilities. We have different vibes in life. We resonate with things very differently. We perceive things very differently. Therefore, acknowledge the grace that is in you and that is in others. The next C we say that to help you as a person to eradicate this according to that parable is learn to celebrate others. Celebrate. Celebrate others. When you see someone has done something you're not able to do, you are there to complete each other. So celebrate them. Thank them. Tell them thank you for doing this. Because you, both of you, or everyone else has 24 hours. You share 24 hours. No one here has 25 hours, 26 hours. We share the same amount of time. So when you're able to do so many things, please look at it as the grace or the ability that God, your creator, has given you by his grace. You're supposed to celebrate those who are able to do more or less. Amen? Last thing we say that let's learn to be contented. Contentment is very, very important. What is to be contented? Who you are. Being satisfied with who you are and what you have. If you're able to practice that, you'll be happy and joyous most time of the 24 hours. Because you see God in whatever you have. Contentment doesn't make you be too comfortable in your comfort zone. No. It's knowing that I have this at this time and I'm heading towards better things. I'm able to do this today, but I'm looking forward to do even much more by the grace of God. You learn to see God in every situation. So in the midst of quarrels, like the children of Israel complaining the first lesson, they are saying, why did you bring us here to die as if there were no graves in Egypt? They were quarreling with Moses. They are quarreling among themselves. They are complaining so much even against God. But we see God fixing their complaints. He sends Moses and tells him, go and do this and that. Strike the rock and the water will come out and they shall drink. The second reading, we see how Paul is trying to teach us in the book of Philippians. He's addressing them, he's telling them, I'm not going to be with you always. You've used to seeing me so much. But I want you with the same strength you've been having to keep serving God with all of joy. He tells them that it's not going to be easy. There will be quarrels amongst yourself. There's a lot of discord. There will be a lot of complaining. People will not appreciate you. People will gossip against you. Others will bring you down, belittle you, make you look small for their own selfish gain. But Paul is telling them, two things you need to remember. To have joy when serving, when doing that which you've seen me do, is number one, I say these 2 points. Attitude. Everybody say attitude. How is your attitude? Whatever you do in this life, from the ones that are taught here by Paul, is that fix your attitude. Fix your what is your attitude? What is your motive behind doing what you do? Be it at workplace, when you wake up and go to work, do you go to work because you're getting a paycheck? Do you know you can serve and glorify God in whatever you do? Do that work as if you're doing it for God, because you're loving God and serving humanity. That is the greatest service you can ever do. When you're serving God's people, whether they are believers or not, let them see the attitude of Christ in you. Attitude is so dangerous, brothers and sisters. It's like a tire? A car has how many tires? 4. When you have one flat tire, are you able to go anywhere? Yes, but it may cause more damage, right? Attitude to me is like a flat tire. You have to stop your car, you fix it, then you move on. Attitude, negative attitude. Many people have negative attitude towards others, towards things, they react with things. You know, these are the things we don't speak openly. And I'm glad that the scriptures are directing us to address them so that we apply them in our personal lives. You can go back to the same story and see how it happened with the Philippians and the kind of attitude they had. But Paul was addressing them, telling them, this is how I expect you to do. But how are those scriptures speaking to you and me today? Fix your attitude. You know how to fix your attitude? Like a flat tire. Come out of your car. Get your toolbox. Fix it. If you're not able to, or you never learned that skill, use money to fix that. But you have to fix it. Otherwise, you pay more money. Have the attitude of Christ. Positive attitude is very, very important. Just a few things about attitude. To be Christ-like or to think like Christ. Those are the things I learned from them. Paul is telling them that in all you do, have Christ-like mind, be Christ-minded. To change your desires to be more like Christ, we need some things. First of all, our desires. Why do we have complaints and quarrels? Do you know where the process of getting quarrels and complaints? It starts from inside. Desires. Envy and jealousy. If you read James, the book of James, it talks about the formula. It says that, why are there quarrels and fights amongst you? Does it not result from the desires, the things from inside that one wants this and the other? Unmet desires. It's things that you want and no one is giving them to you. Do you know people argue and fight over things that are very, very earthly, other than heavenly? We say there is a difference. Heavenly things are things you cannot go to the store and buy them. Can you buy peace from the store? Can you buy joy from the store? Can you buy contentment from the store? But you can buy food. You can buy your bed, but can you buy sleep? Can you? Please talk to me. Can you buy sleep? You can go to the store and buy all the food you want, but can you buy appetite? Let's pursue things that God wants us to pursue, that we live in harmony with Him and with one another. How are we able to take care of our desires? Those things that we desire no one is meeting them. It starts from the heart. And therefore we keep picking up fights with one another. And that is what destroying our families, destroying our relationships at work, destroying our relationships at church and so many other places. A relationship amongst yourself. There are people listening to me here and you don't have your right relationship with yourself. Do you know who you, your greatest enemy? Who is that person? It's not even the devil, it's you. When you go to the home, go look at yourself in the mirror. That person you see, there's no one in life you'll spend more time with other than that person you see in that mirror. Fix that person. Tell them you need to stop this negative attitude. You need to work on your attitude. Go look at yourself in the mirror. That person you see, you need to learn how to relate with them well. That is the person you spend most of your 24 hours with in life. It's not your friends. It's not your spouse. It's that person you see. You are jealous? Fix that person you see in the mirror. You have envy? Fix that person you see in the mirror. You have negative attitude? It's not you. Look at that person in the mirror. So everybody here has something that we can reflect ourselves on. A mirror. Who doesn't have a mirror in their room or in their house? We all have that. Let's use it. Go again, look at yourself and fix that which you want to see in others. The many times we point fingers and complain about things, those are the same things that are affecting us. So when you point fingers, look at those things. If you go and point the mirror through the mirror and point at that person, you see the three fingers are pointing back to you. And the three fingers will be pointing at that guy in the mirror. So it's a two-way. You have to fix yourself, fix that person. Brothers and sisters, we need the Holy Spirit of God to dwell in our hearts, to occupy the space for our desires. The influence of the faithful Christian. Do you know why we come to church and we have fellowship? It's because in the church we have people who've matured in faith more than others. Maybe someone here loved the book of Genesis and they read it deeply and they got a lot of insights there. Someone else read Exodus. Another one read Revelation. Another one James. Another one read the parables. When we meet together, do you know we can enhance one another's faith? Sharpening our skills, sharpening one another with encouragement. When you feel someone is complaining and feeling, oh, God has left me, I don't have this, and you remind them the story of Israel. This is how God fixed them. When you hear someone is afraid of death and not knowing what to do, they're sick in hospital, you remind them of Revelation, that the eternal kingdom that is to come. That Jesus Christ, God, is the Alpha and the end. And the time will come when everybody shall be gone. You've encouraged that person. So our attitude dwells around this way, and we need the Holy Spirit to influence one another with our faith. Come to church. You'll find people who are really willing to encourage one another. Obedience to God's word, not just exposure to it. Most of us we sleep with our Bibles under our pillow. We believe that the faith that is in the Bible can come to us from the Bible to us by osmosis or diffusion. It can't work. It's an action. Read. The word read is an action. It's not a noun. Read means you do what? When I say read, John 3:16, what does it mean? Open John 3:16 and read. It doesn't say that you stay there with John 3:16. And expect God to fix your attitude. No. You have to read. Be action-minded. Don't be exposed to scripture. Read the truth about scripture. If you go out there and it's written exit, and this an occasion in which people are supposed to exit through that door, and you see it's written exit, that word is a verb. It's an action word. When in nature you're supposed to do what? To exit. If you don't, what will happen? You'll perish. Brothers and sisters, let's differentiate between nouns in our lives and the action ones. Read the scripture. Don't just be exposed to it. The next thing is sacrificial service. Most of us work hard so much, but we want to be appreciated. It's nice. It's good to be appreciated. But do you know that we can never get enough appreciation from fellow men or fellow mankind? We can only get the true acknowledgement from God himself. Work as if you're working for that crown, to be told, good and faithful servant, I gave you five, and you're able to multiply that. When you work, work hard in a way that the angels of God will clap for you and God himself will smile. It's all about Jesus. Do it sacrificially. Whatever you find to do, do it with all your heart. As if that's the only last thing that you do in your life. In doing God's will, we desire to do it. Do what Christ wants and trust him to change your desires. You'll find joy in serving Christ. Serving Christ doesn't only happen in church. At your workplace, when you fix your attitude, you'll find joy in doing what you do. At home, when you're doing your chores and complaining, like saying everybody else doesn't do it, no one wants to do this, no one wants to do that, fix your attitude. Do what you cannot do, leave it. Instead of complaining, fix your attitude. Have the attitude of Christ. Fixing your attitude means clothe yourself with Christ-likeness. Ask yourself this simple, what would Jesus Christ do given a chance? Christ would take the trash out for the young people, like the young people who don't like doing this. Christ will sweep the house. Christ will do this and that. Christ will come to church. Jesus Christ will listen, like he does in the gospel today. He goes to the temple and he's teaching, and the teachers of the law comes and ask him, by whose authority are you doing these things? And where did you get it from? And he said that before I answer your question, I need you to answer mine. The baptism of John, did it come from heaven or from mankind? They discuss among themselves, this guy is fixing us. If we say from heaven, he'll ask us, why didn't you believe? And if we say it came from mankind, then the people who think John was a prophet, they'll come after us. That is how life is. We are always surrounded by people who are setting us up. Traps all over. How do you overcome those snares? Have wisdom. Wisdom comes by things like the ones we're talking about here. Attitude. How do we shine brightly? Keep shining. Everybody wants to keep shining and shining, shining, shining. Do you know that when people are clapping for you, you may be headed in the wrong direction? Do you know what? The more you have more followers in social media and think you are likely to become the average of those people's views and comments and how they do it, and you are likely not to tell the truth about who you are. I have nothing against social media. I'm in it, I like it, it's a good thing. But it has killed most of our potentials in so many different ways. Because we follow what people are saying about us and their views, both positive and negative. But how are you to keep shining? Keep shining. I don't mean that you have more followers and people who are telling you, clapping for you. Ask yourself, what is Christ? How is Jesus Christ seeing me and God seeing me, whatever I'm doing? Paul challenges the Philippians that for you to have joy in serving, keep shining brightly for Christ. When you are working there, keep shining brightly for Christ. When you are at home doing everything, keep shining brightly for Christ. When you are in church, you step your feet in here and you're doing something, keep shining brightly for Christ. Say it's all about Jesus. If someone asks you, by whose authority are you doing all of these things? Who told you to do this and that? Don't ask questions like Jesus. It's all about who? Jesus Christ. Work hard to show the result of your salvation, that you believe in God. Working together to rid ourselves of divisions and discords. Our attention and division are very important, because unless we keep them focused to Christ, we shall be sidetracked always. We need to work hard. Who are our enemies when we are serving and with those things, all these things? Complaints, quarrels, what else? Negative attitude, something else? Huh? Envy. What else is our negative enemy? Jealousy, all those things. I want to give us the formula for happiness, true happiness. Number one is humble yourself. In everything you do what? Humble yourself. Humble yourself. And Christ is the perfect example of humility. He humbled himself to death, yet he was God. He had the authority to even get rid of all the betrayers and people around him, but he humbled himself. Humility leads to the next stage, happiness. When you learn to humble yourself, you find yourself happy in so many different ways. It brings happiness. Before happiness, this humility and happiness, in between these two, is what you call harmony. Everybody say harmony. Harmony is what the opposite of discord, disunity, people fighting over each other. So humble yourself, focus on harmony and the peace and working together with others, teamwork. And the last one is you find yourself happy. The joy of serving Christ, attitude, and shining brightly for Christ. You want to be happy? Be humble and foster harmony amongst one another. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sequence hymn in hymnal 691, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Oh, no. Sorry, wrong hymn, sorry.
Rock of Ages.
Yeah, Rock of Ages in hymnal 685. Sorry about that.
Water and the blood from the
2 can be found in the Red Prayer Book, beginning on page 385. I ask your prayers for all God's people through the world, for our presiding Bishop Michael, our Bishop Allen, our assistant Bishop Carroll, our priest in charge Zachary, and other ministers. We pray for our parish, St. Bartholomew, and especially in its collaboration with St. Mark's Dorchester. We also pray for the parishes of the South Shore Deanery, Emmanuel Church in Braintree, Grace Chapel in Brockton, St. Stephen's Church in Cohasset, and Brother of St. Andrew. I ask your prayers for peace for our President Joseph, Vice President Kamala, our Governor Mara, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, the addicted, those in jail or prison, and all who are living in fear. I ask your prayers for all of those on our parish prayer list. These include our presiding Bishop Michael Curry, Carol Alexander, Richard Bridgman, Beryl Carter, Mita Fontelio, Elsie Green, Colette Griffith, Marjorie Griffith, Juanita Hardrick, Gail Harris, the Reverend Florence King, Alfred Lane, Jermaine Mayers, Sandra Morrell, Delphina Peniston, Austin Prescott, Amelia Taylor, Lambert Webb, Sonia Weir, and Vashti Weir. Pray for those in need or trouble. And we pray for family and friends. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of Him. I ask your prayers for the departed, especially the loved ones and friends of the people gathered here this morning. Pray for those who have died. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glory Christ in our own day.
Sees in secret. strengthen you in all goodness, and by all the Holy Spirit keep you in the temple. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
We'll
share this peace with one another. Thank you.
those worshiping with us online would like a deeper connection with us, prayers, or just a conversation with our minister, please feel free to reach out through our church contact, either telephone or email. We'd be happy to follow up with you. Okay. We thank God for last Sunday's homecoming service and fellowship. We had a wonderful time. We were joined also by the wardens and some members of the St. Mark's Church. We appreciated all those who helped in so many ways. Thank you. Now, the painting of the sanctuary wall behind the altar has been completed. We thank God for this great achievement. This was made possible from the funds raised during our April 29th gospel concert and some funds from the church general account. Many thanks to everyone that has helped in one way or another, especially with the clearance before painting, cleaning, and setting up the altar again. But we're still looking forward to getting more finances from parishioners, friends, any donations, so that we can continue the rest of the job. So any donations are appreciated. Our priest in charge, Brother Zachary, will be out of the office on Tuesday the 3rd for the annual Diocesan Clergy Day. Bible study sessions are ongoing. As follows, St. Mark's is the study of Joshua, and it's on Tuesday night from 8 till 9 p.m. on Zoom. St. Bartholomew's is the study of Moses and the Ten Commandments, and it's on Thursday nights from 5:30 to 6:30 on Zoom. This is a recurring meeting, so you can use the same meeting ID and passcode each Thursday or Tuesday evening. All are welcome to join. We started our session ministry called the Ushering and Connection Team. Some of the roles of this team is to meet and greet, reach out to visitors on Sundays by welcoming them, connecting with them through after-service fellowship, and collecting basic information such as their name and address, etc. The team will also assist with ushering during our worship services and other duties as needed. The deadline for signing up for this is next Sunday, October the 8th. My anniversary. Please talk to the wardens if you are interested, or sign up on the sheet on the table downstairs. Our month of October healing service will be next week on the 8th. So let's remember to invite families, friends, neighbors, colleagues to our healing service next Sunday. Cambridge Episcopal Church's clergy have been meeting bi-monthly for conversation on how the four congregations can deepen their connections in the spirit of invite, welcome, and connect. Each church will have a chance to host a midweek service. We're all invited to gather for a joint creation care celebration at St. James Episcopal Church, Cambridge, October 12th at 7 p.m. You could also get a flyer in the parish hall, from the table in the parish hall, if you're interested. The Roxbury Dorchester Power in the community is presenting a senior luncheon on Tuesday, October 17th, from noon to 4. The luncheon will be on Venezia Restaurant waterfront. So it will be on the at the restaurant Venezia on the waterfront, Erickson Street in Boston. Flyers with more detailed information on reservations are located in the parish hall. Our assistant bishop, the Right Reverend Carol Gallagher, will be visiting us on October 22nd. The bishop will be our preacher and celebrant for that day. There will be a St. Mark's and St. Bartholomew's joint service this month on Sunday the 29th. There will be a joint service with the two churches in Calvary collaboration. The priest in charge will elaborate further on this.
I'm waiting for permission. Before I call Clark, let me elaborate further as it comes. Yes, as you can, we are hoping to have a joint service. As you all know, we are in collaboration with St. Mark's and St. Bartholomew's. And it might be my prayer and desire to see us worship the Lord together in harmony as we learn to have a fellowship. We've tried different ways. We started with the vestries, where we did the first joint vestry kind of retreat, and it happened here. It was very successful. Then in August, we did another one at St. Mark's, the second one. Very successful. And all the good things that we learned together, we ask ourselves, when can we have a good time to be able to meet as a congregation and reach out to the members? So the only way that has come is to have a joint service. And because October has 5 Sundays, we wanted to make use of the 5th Sunday of the month so that we meet together in a joint fellowship. Now we are using 2 things to bring us together. First of all, 3 things. First of all is the worship of God. Gather us by His power and Spirit. Number 2, we use food. We come together and eat and share. So if you have your various food that you know how to make, this is the day that we can give you more details. The rest is music. Some people here can dance very well. And therefore we can come together, we sing, dance, and glorify the Lord together with members of St. Mark's. We've already done our first meeting with the 4 wardens, and the agreement has been where and when. So when we've already been told is when? October 29th. Now, where is the question? We agreed that we're going to do two joint services, one this time and another one in the near future. One will be indoor, the other one will be outdoor. So we say that for the first time we're going to host this service at St. Bartholomew's Parish. A big love for the Lord. So that means that when the guests are coming, it will be hosted here. We'll have a joint service. We'll plan. Maybe our plans are underway on how St. Mark's members will come here. We agree on time and how the service will be. Nothing is planned here. If you have ideas there, please reach out to the wardens or myself and or any vestry member. I'll be happy to incorporate. This is the first thing, so we would like to hear your contributions. We hope that we'll worship together. The only challenge I'm giving us is one, pray, and then you avail yourself. It would be very unfair to have guests come and then host out of them. Please plan to be there, and when called upon to do something, please avail yourself and bring your ideas and support and let us work together. Amen? I want to call my brother Clark to make an announcement before the prayer permission.
Morning, everyone. The nominating committee for the new bishop has set up a series of listening sessions all around the diocese to hear from you, the members of our diocese. Started a little over a week ago, and is continuing on for the next couple of weeks. I'd like to bring a couple of sessions to your attention in particular. Tomorrow at St. James Church, there'll be a listening session from 6:30 to 8 p.m. St. James Church in Cambridge in Porter Square. So if you're trying to figure out, how am I going to navigate St. James for October 12th, this will be a good opportunity to go early and learn all about the church, right? But mostly you'll get to talk to us about what you want from the bishop who is going to lead our parish. There'll also be a lay session by Zoom on Tuesday, and there'll be a lay session for people of color on October 5th at Trinity Church in Boston. And there's a whole series of these that will go through October 15th. If those dates don't work for you, come see me. I can tell you the others. You should also have email from the diocese with the entire list.
I believe Teresa has an announcement as well.
As she comes, I want to take this chance we pray for the election of Bishop, but thank you so much. We are blessed as a parish because we have one of us who is a member of that such committee, and we thank God for that and rest. We pray for you. Let us join together in prayer for the election of Bishop. Together, Almighty God, give of every good gift, look graciously on your church, and so guide the minds of those who shall choose the bishop for this diocese, that we may receive a faithful person who care for your people and equip us for the ministries through Jesus Christ.
Okay, the next thing is a presentation to RPIC. Reverend Zachary, can you stand up? Okay, so we found out that this month is Clergy Appreciation Month. So, since we appreciate our priest in charge so much, the first appreciation gift is a gift from the vestry and the St. Bartholomew's parishioners.
Thank you.
All the time.
Yeah. Should we pray for this gift? Let us pray. No, in Africa, we say wonders will never cease. This is the wonders. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this wonderful time you've given us. You've called us to always be the lookout for the good things with which you can glorify your name. Lord, we have a gift here that has been given to the priest in charge of this parish, not because he deserves it, but because of the thoughtfulness of the dear people in this parish, especially the members. I pray for blessing upon them, O Lord, that every their needs and desires may be fulfilled. We pray for this gift, accepting for the ministry that may be used for your good work here in this parish and here. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Okay, special prayers. First, Stephen Maskell is still in Brigham and Women's Hospital, but he wanted to say thank you to all that have wished him well and give him a call or send him a card. Wanted to let you guys know that he is doing much better and he's looking forward to be out soon. And then a special prayer for Gail Harris, who is in Mass General Hospital ICU at the moment, and she needs all the prayers and blessings that we can give. Birthdays. Anybody celebrating a birthday today? We have two birthdays, Holly Allen and Laura Pipkin. Anyone else celebrating a birthday, anniversary, traveling?
Birthdays, traveling, you're welcome. And, if you're there, say, you can stand up if you have, I don't see our ambassador, but you can raise, if you have a kid or a nephew or a niece that you pray for, you can stand up there and help you pray. As I ask, so here for prayers. Let's pray for our kids. Our dear Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you so much because you granted us the blessing of kids in our midst. We pray for this kid, oh Lord. We pray for those who are on YouTube and they have kids in their families, and those who are here, and those who school around in this place. We pray for blessing upon them in Jesus' name. We continue growing them in wisdom, such as your Son Jesus Christ, as we ask in His name. Amen. Let's pray for birthdays. Anniversary, traveling, right? So we have anniversary and traveling. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you because in your able hands, Lord, we find solace and strength. We cannot be tired of giving thanks to you because of the mercies that you've given to your people when they travel and come back, and we share things. Lord, we continue asking the same grace to be upon them, your safety, your protection, and your love shall accompany wherever they go. Ambassadors of St. Lord, you see in Cambridge, Lord, they may come back to us with love and care. We thank you for the mission which they are going to accomplish. Make it possible for you. Glory and honor of your name. You also remember good friends who are celebrating their anniversary. Today we pray for blessing upon them, O God, that it may be for your will and glory that they continue being in peace together. Glory to your holy name in all their endeavors. We ask that you may shine upon all these dear ones and so many others who are on YouTube too, celebrating this important occasion in their life. Bless them all in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. Let's appreciate them. This time we're going to walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us and offering sacrifice to God.
The offertory hymn is found in hymnal 686, Come Thou Font.
Mercy, 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 m
basic prayer here at 361. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, joyful. What a joyful day always a day to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Lord of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In fulfillment of his true promise, the Holy Spirit came down from heaven, lighting upon the disciples to teach them and to lead them into all truth, uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith, and giving to your church the power to serve you as a royal priesthood and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn and give the glory of your name. Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for me, for the forgiveness of sins. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ is Lord.
Amen. We celebrate the memorial of redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him. In him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, mighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has told us, we want to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who us from our temptation, but leave us to heal, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory,
forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia. Passover is sacrificed for us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. You are all welcome to take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him. Your hearts with my faith.
The recessional hymn is hymn 344 in the hymnal, Lord Dismiss Us With. The communion hymn, Trust and Obey, and lift every voice and sing, number 305.
Thank you.
prayer, page 366. Do you arise, please? Let us pray. Mighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us the spirit of your food, the most precious body, blood,
of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for showing us in these holy mysteries, that we are living members of the body of your Son, and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to his Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
I want to take this time to thank all of you for the great work you've done. Thank you so much, brother, for doing the camera. Thank you for us who did the sound. We want to thank all the ushers, those who read, those who did music, the choir, and the pace, and my helpers here, together with Victor, Joy, and Sherry, and all of you for doing one thing or the other. Those who prepared the deal we're going to share, thank you very much. Bless you for every single thing you've done or you've done this week. And especially those who came and helped with the painting of the wall, we thank God. Can we give a clap to all of us for a big welcome? Now we want to thank God for this great progress that he has given us. We can't take it for granted because he has made it possible for us with our resources, with our capacity. He has given us good things. Let's appreciate God. Of praise and dance. Let us pray. Send us out, O Lord, with your blessing. May your peace that surpasses all comprehension and understanding continue guiding our hearts in the knowledge, love of you, God, through the Son, that love of your Son, Jesus Christ. May the blessing of your God, mighty Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now.
Amen. And now the recessional hymn found in the hymnal 344, Lord, dismiss us with.
Thank you.
out of the world, clothe ourselves with the attitude of Christ, and we keep shining bright in His name as we go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.